The reason we're talking about all this is so that, number one, you'll be free from whatever attachment you have. And then you'll be able to live the life you want to live. You will know that I am in here for just for myself. And there is the reason you came to church is because you wanted to get saved. And the reason you keep coming to church is because you want to get to heaven. And so you never remove your mind from that focus. And the reason I go about preaching is to get people to heaven. My reason for going about to places is not to support, you know, any ministry or support any minister, or to be able to say, well, that whether the thing is right or wrong, just follow through. I want to be able to take as many people as I can to heaven, and you will get there. And the reason is sometimes, you know, I told you in my message, I think it was on Friday, I said some people behave like babies and some people became like they behave like toddlers. And when you're praying, they say, that's enough. And after I said that, some people, I know this society is a society that said, no, you cannot control us. And when I said that, some people still did that after that service. And so I came yesterday and I said it again. And, you know, if you do it again now, when I come next, I'll say it again. Because I know that if you don't give the Holy Spirit the leeway, the green light, and the liberty to do whatever he wants to do, and you take the place of the Holy Spirit, I know the consequence upon your life. That's why I keep on saying that, so that you will wake up one day and then you let go and let God be God. So that the people that need to pray and the people that need to seek the face of the Lord and the people that need to find their way back to Calvary, they'll be able to do that without your hindrance and without your interference. And that's the reason why I keep on saying what I'm saying. And if we get it this time, I'll be so happy. I'll be, you know, running back. I'll say, I need to get back to that place again. But if you don't get it, I'll say, I think I need to come back earlier. Because those people, I said it, they didn't get it. Then I'll come back and say it again. I said, I'll say it again. After all you can do is to frown at me. You know, you have it the same. You still have some, you know, Nigerian, African respect not to slap me, I hope. And even if you did, I'll pray for the grace of Paul the Apostle that none of these things move me. Neither count I my life, my personality dear unto me, but I'll finish the work that God has given me to do. And the reason for that is just to make sure that by all means we get there, we're going to get there. We're looking at now the second point, which is the good way of sustained godliness. Titus chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 11. Titus chapter 2, verse 11, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness, that's what you need to do, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly when? In this present world, that we live in godliness. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. But refuse profane and old wise fables, and exercise thyself rather unto what? Godliness. Exercise thyself unto godliness. I said it earlier, that this nation in particular, this nation is the leading nation on exercise. And the industry is, you know, getting wider and wider. The people want to live up to, you know, 100 years and 120 years. And they're telling us that the science and technology here now, if you eat the right thing and exercise the right way, you can live up to 90 and up to 100. And I'm asking, what do you want to live up to 100 and up to 120 years of age? And there's nothing you've done for the last 70 years. And you don't have any plan to do anything different. Why just live long and then there is no quality of that life? It's not just exercise, it's the godliness. If we become more serious about godliness than as we are being, or more than we are being on exercise, then we'll be going somewhere and we will get there in Jesus' name. Then it says in verse 8, for bodily exercise profiteth little. bodily exercise profited little. Only make you to shed a little weight and, you know, can make your heart condition to be better and can get rid of, you know, stress and some of these things. But all that is still profits little. But then it tells us, but godliness is profitable. How? Unto all things. Why don't you spend more time on that then, instead of just looking at the weight and weighing yourself every time and saying, I must shed this, I must shed. That's good, that's good. You can shed that. But how about the other things you have to shed? In your character, in your behavior, in your attitude. The anger, the malice, and the unforgiving spirit, and the greed, and the covetousness, and all these negative interpersonal relationships that shed all those things. That's why it says, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having the promise of the life that now is, and that, and of that which is to come. Godliness. We're looking at chapter 6 of 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 6, I'm looking at it from verse 3. If any man teacheth otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness. Doctrine which is according to godliness. The doctrine we need to preach and emphasize is that which leads us and leads our hearers, leads the people unto godliness. Look at verse 6, for godliness with contentment is great gain. Godliness with contentment, that is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. Having food and raiment, let us therewith be content. But they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is what? The root of all evil. I know some people, especially those, you know, in our country here, we have these motivational speakers that talk on prosperity, prosperity. And I'm very quick to point to this verse, and they say, the Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. It doesn't say money. Yes, I understand, I understand. But show me the man that, you know, has money and is not going to have the accompanying thing, the love of money with it. Very few of them. And you know that over here we have kind of seminars held for only millionaires. And there are people that are striving and striving and striving. I want to be able to qualify and get into that kind of seminar. I think you need to strive to get to the seminar of holy people, righteous people, saintliness and godliness. Because all that, the love of money is the root of all evil. And sometimes you are in this job, you want to get that job and get that job. And you even refuse to take care of yourself and take care of your family because you want to amass quite a lot of health. Don't let all these people, you know, kind of brainwash us and say, we need to have this, we need to have that. You know, prosperity is good, but if that prosperity goes between you and eternal life, that's going to be terrible. I said that's terrible. Look at verse 10, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after what? After that what? And then what? And then? And then? And then? It says, pursue that. Run after that.
You have received the message from our pastor, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, the General Superintendent of the Palai Bible Church. It is my wish that as you listen, you accept the old word and you will let them sink into your heart. And by the grace of the Lord, you will never regret it. It is my prayer that by next week, when our pastor shall come up again to present another message, you will be there, your family will be there, and your friends. And I believe as you are listening to the message every week, by the grace of the Lord, you will never be the same. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, O Lord, because of today's message. We thank you, O Lord, because of the one you let us listen to last week, and the one we are going to listen to the next week, by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ. If you tarry, we shall listen together once again next week. And if not, every one of us will be there with you in the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because you are the Lord that answers prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.